1:30. We'll go ahead and get started. Thank you all for coming. As you know, this is the project team that the Board of Commissioners approved, put together some time ago. This is our kickoff meeting. And of course, we've got the project team here. Go ahead and call the meeting to order. And what I'd like to do first, for the everybody's benefit, is to go around the room for those that are team members, and there are 9 team members. You just introduce yourself and tell us what office you're with. Appreciate it. Anybody?
Donna Kukarola, Procurement.
Dave Thornton, with the Public Facilities.
Dr. C. Rose, Capital Project.
Todd LeVay, Commissioner.
David Gruen, Finance.
Ted Paxton, Sheriff.
Mayor Gravitt, Cumming.
Pete Amos, Commissioner.
Jeff Bagley, Chief Superior Court Judge, Bell, Forsyth Judicial Circuit.
And I'm Doug Bear, County in Forsyth County. Any of you have support staff here? Dave Thornton, as a member, has Steve Rhodes here as support staff. Sheriff?
No. Judge Smith, Cap Smith. Okay.
Any other support
staff? And I have Don Childress, who's Court Administrator for the Bell Forsyth Circuit.
Okay. Mayor, any?
Yes, I have Director of Planning and Zoning, Scott Morgan.
Okay. Thank you. The first item on the agenda is the adoption of the agenda. You have one each member. You have in front of you now a SPLOST VII DL Courthouse Project Team binder, and as you can see, the public notice that went out for today's meeting is under the first tab under agendas and minutes, and that has got today's agenda on it as well. In addition to that agenda, as you can see, it says the purpose of the meeting will be for discussion and consideration of the items as outlined on the agenda listed below and such other business as may properly come before the committee. So in addition to that agenda, to actually cover item 4, items consideration discussion, number 1, there's an agenda or additional information that Kathy McWilliams is handing out if you want to follow along using that. And that covers primarily everything that's in item number 1 under the agenda. So once you look at that and refer back to the first tab, your motion to adopt the agenda as presented.
So moved.
And I forgot to introduce Kathy McWilliams in my office. She'll be here in 8 minutes and for the meeting. We had a motion. Commissioner Amos. Second, Commissioner Levent. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, there being none, we'll move on to the agenda. Items for consideration and discussion, refer back to the expanded agenda I just gave to you. I'm going to do some things that bring you up to date. Some of those will be in this presentation that I'll go through in just a minute. And then the other is the program management, project construction delivery method, funding options, schedule development. Those will be covered in the meeting as well. I've already handed out the binder. Just kind of a quick overview of the binder. You can see for yourself, but because this is our first meeting, we put together this binder for you. You've got, under the second tab, you've got membership, and that lays out the team members, how they were created, when they were created, and they were approved January 24, 2012 at a work session, ratified on 2-2 upon consent agenda by the Board of Commissioners, and the section following it is the team members below. The next tab is project overview. That's what's on the screen right now that I'm going to go over in just a minute. And then we've got delivery methods. That's going to be part of the agenda as well today. Dr. Kukarola is going to give you a briefing on the different program management delivery methods that are available. And then program study. That study is one that was commissioned some time ago. That is in your books. We'll refer to a couple items in that book as well for the meeting. Preliminary schedule. That was a schedule that was produced some months ago as a guide, if you will, to scheduling of the projects. And then, of course, the back section is for notes if you should desire to take some. And by the way, interrupt me whenever you want. We'll talk about a particular matter along the way. We're certainly able to do that as well. I'm going to go ahead and go through this presentation very quickly. There's a few of you I know who just have an hour, and we will try to go through this as quickly as possible. This is a presentation that you have, some of you have seen before, but for the benefit of those that haven't, go ahead and go through it. It's got some good information in it, and it brings you up to speed on some things we've worked on. This first section is just historical data, SPLOST VI, previously approved by the voters, and as you know, collections for SPLOST VI expire on June 30th. SPLOST VII, again, as you know, November 8th, 2011 referendum. That was for continuation of sales and use tax for a period of 6 years. And of course, it was approved by the voters, and collections would begin, or will begin, July 1st, 2013, and run 6 years through June 30th, 2019. This is just the ballot language for the special local option sales tax. We've seen that before. The SPLOST VII proposed projects, total proposed, are broken down into two categories. Category A at approximately $180 million, and priority category B projects at just under $30 million. And the total projected to raise during the six-year period is estimated at $200 million. This is category A projects, proposed projects, and that is the project list that was approved by the board. This is the category A project continuation, and you'll see down toward the bottom highlighted is the proposed jail expansion, courthouse and related parking facilities, and you see that figure there was estimated at approximately $100 million for those projects. That's category B projects. You've seen that before. And then the components of priority or category A projects list. As you know, I won't go through all this. As you know, the first bullet point is $100 million for the jail, courthouse, and parking facility. And then the very bottom, the ballot language authorizes up to a little over $89 million of debt that may be used by the county in whole or in part to pay for the projects. This is the proposed jail expansion, courthouse, and related parking facilities. This conceptual plan, you see where the proposed new courthouse would be built, the proposed parking facility directly behind it, and then the proposed jail expansion on the site the current jail is today. We already went through this. This is the members and representatives approved by the board. You all are here today. Project team will review preliminary planning and programming. We'll do that today. Budget and schedule, we'll do some of that today as well. Evaluate various construction delivery methods. I alluded to that earlier. We'll go into that in just a few minutes. And then, of course, meet on an as-needed basis to manage the project through completion. And, of course, we would consult with the Board of Commissioners on various matters, and consult with the program or project manager, architect, and others to ensure the project is properly managed. Other considerations, buildings currently located on the site of the new courthouse, 101 East Main Street, the Sheriff's Office is there. We have closed on that property. 104 Veterans Memorial Boulevard, where Indigent Defense currently is, we've closed on that property. 110 Veterans Memorial Boulevard, that is tenant occupied. We closed on that property. And 116 Veterans Memorial Boulevard is tenant occupied. We closed on that property as well. There's a need to relocate current tenants. The one at 101 where the Sheriff's Office currently is, they currently house approximately 12,580 square feet. They will have to relocate it before the buildings are raised. And Indigent Defense at 104 Veterans Memorial Boulevard. They currently occupy 720 square feet. They will need to be relocated as well. And myself and staff are currently working on those projects to find them a place to relocate to. Other current tenants, 110 Veterans Memorial, the lease terminates on that particular property February 28, 2014. Staff and forth the Board of Commissioners, and I'm sure this committee knows already, that I'm quite sure that we would move forward prior to that, so that tenant would have to be relocated. The 116 Veterans Memorial Boulevard, that lease terminates May 31st, 2012, and that tenant has already relocated. Some of the challenges that this committee will discuss, certainly there will be more discussed than what's on the slide, but in general, we've got to discuss parking challenges during the demolition and construction of the project for both the public, the jurors, and of course the employees. And the project team will evaluate the needs as we get to that subject matter. Funding options for jail, courthouse, parking facilities. Finance department today is here, and they will go over some funding options for us with respect to funding the project. Any questions about that? That's very similar to the presentation that was given to the Board of Commissioners some time ago, but I wasn't sure if all of you saw that, and I made some changes, updated some of the information in it for your benefit. If there are no questions, we'll move on to the next item, and that is program management and construction delivery methods. Donna Kukarola, our Director of Procurement, has provided us some information. It's in your binder. Additionally, she will go through some of these delivery methods and then potentially open the floor for discussion on how you might want to move forward with the project. Madam?
Thanks, Jeff. Thank you, everyone. It is in your book, as Doug just said, but basically there's two factors to be considered. One is your program management and one is your delivery method. The program management would be the one that would be looking out for our best interests on the site and on the job. There are two major construction projects, as you know. The parking deck I've rather put in with the courthouse as a construction, even though that might be a separate specialized consultant, that probably would be under one heading. And then you would have your jail, your detention center. So it would be highly recommended to go forward with a program manager and have that person be involved with us from the very beginning and assist us, be one point of contact for all of our projects, the whole project as it sits, and also be the main focal point who we would contact from the county standpoint. Not saying we wouldn't be involved with the architects and with the contractors, but we'd have one focal point. They would be the ones that would be charged with ensuring the schedule is being met, the quality is being met, and all the requirements have been hit. They provide the expertise. This person would be, anyone that was chosen would definitely be based on qualifications, and it would be based on their experience in building courthouses and detention centers specifically. Then you go into your delivery method, and when you do delivery method, you're talking about your solicitation method. And there are a number of different avenues to do construction delivery nowadays. And I've listed a few things that should be considered when we decide on a delivery method. If I'm buying pencils, other things are gonna be more important than versus a building versus a courthouse and a jail. So some of the things we look at are, you know, lowest cost, highest quality. We want initial cost versus your life cycle cost. Don't want to just look at what it's costing today, but what it will cost you in the future. There's scheduling. You have your technical specifications that we'd like to look at. Some value in engineering and innovation that's available out there that we might not have thought of. We're going to take people's expertise and use that. And then we want to limit some things. We want to limit the cost of design changes. We want to limit the risk of cost and schedule changes. And then we want to see who is going to demand of our owner resources, meaning all of our times. How much time does the county have to put into it, meaning, and the expertise of building these facilities? So these are some of the items that we need to consider. The second sheet in your book just goes over the main methodology of procurement. The first one is your traditional design bid build, which most of you are familiar with. We literally design the project, we go out for a hard bid, and then we build it. You'll see there's pros and cons on both things. This is least suited for complex projects, and this is considered a very complex project, so I would not think that might be the most recommended methodology, but it's one definitely to be considered. The next one is a competitive sealed proposal. This is similar to your design bid build, but instead of, you're going to have a little bit more leeway in your hiring of your contractor, because you'll base it some more on qualifications. The design bid build, again, is more restrictive in hiring. You usually go with the lowest responsible bidder. So on the competitive sealed proposal, a little bit more leeway, in meaning that we're going to look more at qualifications as well as that final price. Then the next one that you hear a lot about is design build, and that's literally what it sounds like. You hire someone, and either the architect or the contractor takes the lead, but they're a team. They are a team effort, and they design it and they build it. It is the fastest delivery methodology. It's not good for small projects, of course. It's good for the larger projects. There's a single point of contact, but we don't have as much control. They have more control over each other than we have control with them. So we don't have another set of eyes looking at it. It's not a bad thing, but they are together, and so the county manager or the program manager would be our only other outside source. And then the last one I have listed is the construction manager at risk. This one is, we have used it in the past in the county on a couple projects. The construction manager is brought on earlier in the design phase, so they can add their expertise and help us with some of the value engineering or the innovation. They're usually brought in at a set price up to we get to the guaranteed maximum price that we set the building at. It's a faster delivery, again, a little bit faster because we can start things. The transfer of responsibility for construction and some of the risk goes from the owner to the construction manager, and that's why they call it at risk, because they will be taking ownership of getting the project done in the methodology that we prescribe. So that's it very quickly. If you have any questions or any comment.
Yes, question, Mr. Chairman. I assume you're going to be the chairman of this board.
Well, that's a great question. It's up to this board. If you want to get that formal, we can certainly do that. It's up to this committee.
Well,
to move forward.
Question was, and I'm sure you can answer this. This board is a recommending board only and has no authority as far as that goes to do anything, right?
That's correct. That's correct.
Would you mind just having a facilitator for this company, Mayor? Would you rather go real formal and have a chair?
Probably the chairman would serve the board best, because I think they could facilitate the needs of what the board requested probably better than a facilitator. It's up to the board. I could go either way.
And that's certainly something we can add to the agenda if you want to take a vote on it. So, you want to add that now, or do you want to go on and talk a little bit more about the delivery methods?
I think we can all assume that you can act as chairman, so I prefer to go on right now with what we're talking about.
You want to vote? Does the committee want to vote on it, or simply?
We probably should go ahead and get the formality out of the way.
I'm making a nomination for Chef Doug Deere as our chairman.
I second that.
First and second.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. For those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
I have a question for Donna on procurement policies. Those of us who are not familiar with procurement rules, when is it that we have to stop entertaining guests who come to our office and say, I'd like to talk to you about this project? Is it now? I mean, do we, or what is that under the rules?
No, according to the rules, right now it's still open, okay. Seasoned, I'll put it that way. You definitely can talk to folks and discuss it. There's not a whole lot that isn't open to the public right now anyway, so there's not a whole lot of information. Once we go out on the street with a solicitation, I would say at that point in time, it stops.
Okay.
It stops.
We won't do anything improper. I
appreciate that, Judge.
Another question, and Donna, you can finance director might be more open to this, is that the projected cost of the jail and the courthouse, we had a cap on it, was voted on for $100 million. And I noticed there was $89 million, and that was amortized out till year 2000, maybe 2019 or something to that effect. Is it considered that the balance of that from $89 million, the other $11 million would be the interest that would be paid?
I'll defer that to David.
I think that's what was anticipated in coming up with a number less than $100 million. And I know at this point we're not going to have, I think, that kind of cost in borrowing. But as far as I'm concerned, the $100 million is in total what will be available.
And I think it to be.
Mayor, maybe I can help with that. The $89 million was decided upon as a figure that if in fact the Board of Commissioners and now this committee wanted to move forward with the project very, very quickly, earlier than any funds would begin to start coming in July of 2013, that the funds would be there should we choose to use them and borrow them to start the project. That was just a number that would be available to the board if they chose to move forward. We anticipate, quite frankly, using just a portion of that to get this project started, and it depends on the schedule.
Just a little bit of info on that. I think that was the intent of everybody involved in working to get the passage of the sales tax was to, a year and a half early, was to do this early.
Yes.
During the economic slowdown and thought get a better price. So, and the discussion was at that time to use local funds rather than bond this and pay the bonding fee and all the fees that attributed to selling the bonds, the legal fees and so forth, and deal with the local banks here to use that money to get started early. So hopefully we're not going to be a year and a half before we get started, because the purpose of having the election early, a year and a half early, was to get started on these projects so we could get them done.
Yes, sir. And we do have that as one of the
so we won't have to be
points.
Won't have to be using the $11 million for interest. I think what I was reading was like up to 8% interest. Well, we know we can get money a lot cheaper than 8% interest. And so that was where the $11 million is where I read that came in. So hopefully we can save a tremendous amount of money and get close to the total $100 million on both of the projects.
Yes, sir. And Dave Gruen, we'll talk about that in just a few minutes when we talk about the funding options. Thank you, Dave. Does this committee want to move forward and discuss the delivery methods available to us now and perhaps get to a point either in this meeting or in the next meeting to where we would want to make a recommendation to the Board of Commissioners?
Well, I've just got
or do you want to study it more? Here's something I can copy for if you want to study it a little bit more.
I've got a question about this. Now, if we were to go with the design-build option, so you've got the architect, the engineers, as a team with the contractor, that's what that is.
Mm-hmm.
But we'd also have a project manager that would be paid separately to oversee the project and make sure that it's going as it's supposed to go. Is that correct?
Program.
They would actually be
program manager.
Yeah, they would be working for us. The program manager would be working for us.
Correct. For the county.
Yeah.
Don, is it fair then to say that if this committee goes in the direction of a program manager, and then the method being whether it's design build or construction manager at risk, we would still have that program manager to oversee regardless of which method they
yes.
choose?
I would strongly recommend that a program manager be engaged no matter what delivery method was chosen.
Okay.
That would be totally separate from the delivery
and
method.
And will the program manager, will that go out for bid as well? That job?
That it's a solicitation. It would be a request for proposal. It would be based on qualification.
Okay. How soon would we hire one? I mean, what phase this would be hiring?
That would be the first thing we would do. And once I'm given direction, I can do that. It would probably be out on the street once the requirements are. I would say 4 to 6 weeks to give people time to respond, and then we'd have the evaluation process.
Well, what's the difference in the design build and the competitive seal proposal? I don't really understand that.
Well, the competitive seal proposal is more in line with the design bid build, the traditional. It's just that instead of it being bid, the construction bid out, it would be a proposal, and it would have qualifications as well as just the pricing in it. So that's the biggest difference. It's a methodology that the state of Georgia now embraces and we can handle. It gives us a little bit more leeway. When you do the traditional, you're still going to be doing the design, bid, and build, but instead of being the bid, you're going to be doing the RFP. That's the biggest difference, I would say. Change that word. It is still a little bit slower, but again, it allows for more qualification-based contractors versus just price.
And advantages, again, I know it's in here, but advantages with the construction manager at risk?
The construction manager at risk, this is really, it is meant for large complex projects. I mean, that's what it's for. You would not do this on a small project. It wouldn't be worth the companies and the architect's while, nor the counties. It is really, it does build in a faster delivery because you can be designing and moving forward and starting construction actually before the full design is done, if necessary. That is a possibility with it. It brings in your contractors, and the contractors have a lot of value that we sometimes don't utilize. And this way you have your program manager, you have your architects on board, you have your contractors coming in, and they could be looking at the plans. But we want to definitely, to go back to you, Mr. Mayor, is we want to have it designed and built to our budget. So even though we want to look at all the innovative ways we can do this and all the needs that you have to be met, that's wonderful, but we want to make sure we can design it and build it to your budget. So when you have that contractor involved in that early stage, I think that's a real plus. They're the ones, even though the engineers and your architects do their cost breakouts, these are folks that are actually doing it, and they can help us ensure that we meet the project as desired.
I think you're probably looking at the construction manager as an insurance policy for the county. Make sure you get your product that you bid on.
In a way, that's a very good way. That's it.
For as little as money as possible. It's not the policy.
And that's when you take that risk part of it. We're transferring some of that risk because at a certain point, once the design is usually less than 70% complete, we're going to get our guaranteed maximum price that's going to be built for. And so that contractor and everybody involved in the project is working towards that goal.
It looks like on the design bill, the only downside is that you lose the check and balance between the architect, engineer, and the contractor. However, if you've got a program manager, that concern seems to go away because your program manager can serve as that check and balance. Because I assume your program manager is going to be an architect, engineer type anyway. Am I wrong about that? Or is that?
Yeah, obviously, we've got to have that. When this construction manager, whoever, they're going to have the knowledge of this type of construction.
It is a little bit more of a challenge to manage. Even though we have a program manager, it will be more of a challenge for them to manage a design build.
So would you say with your program manager, which one would you recommend since you've done this over and over again? Maybe not this magnitude.
This is a big project for the county.
It's a very big project.
Maybe, very big project.
Yeah, it'll be the biggest one's ever done.
Mm-hmm. It's an exciting project. And definitely if the board approves us going forward with the program manager, I would, if you're asking for my recommendation, sir, I would say program manager with a construction manager at risk.
Further discussion?
Did you say the last one, Donna? The construction manager, which one?
At risk, yes, sir.
Is there any utility at all in if this committee were to approve moving forward with the RFQ or RFP for the project manager or program manager? Would the delivery method, could it be discussed again with the program manager? And we might get a better feel from that individual what direction to go in?
Would that
be appropriate?
That we definitely could do that. That's definitely an option.
Are we losing time if we do it that way?
You can, because we could have multiple things going on, but you definitely want your program manager to be involved with with selection of the architect, I would say, and definitely the contractor. But you'd slow it down a little bit, but not that much.
So the presumption is, I think the first order of business is if we decide to do a program manager.
That is correct, sir.
We do that, and then we have got a little bit of a cushion to then come to a final resolution of which particular model we want to go by.
That is correct, sir.
It's fair assessment.
It might be appropriate if somebody wanted to make a motion.
I'll make a motion.
You make a motion that we RFP for a
program manager. RFP for a program manager.
I'll second that.
Is it Q? The RFP or Q?
The request for proposal.
A proposal.
A proposal.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? Those in favor?
And I understand this is to solicit or advertise for a program manager or employ a program manager.
Yes, sir. Solicit.
What's the procedure?
Solicit for
a program manager. We'd actually go out for a request, and we would have requirements in the request, the solicitation, and interested parties would be able to submit within our guidelines. And basically, we'd be looking for the qualifications that they could run the program, the construction side and everything, for these projects. And at that time, and that's one question I would ask is, you know, when we receive the proposals, is this team the selection committee, or we'll have a smaller selection committee for review and rating of the proposals? And then usually you also will interview your top couple and then negotiate final pricing.
Okay, the procedure then would be to solicit people for the program manager rather than advertise for it and taking up that additional time and 30 days advertising or something to that effect?
You still advertise it. I'm not sure. It would still be on the street as a solicitation, as an RFP, a request for proposal. And it would be out on the street. I would say it needs to be out at least 4 weeks at a minimum, and up to six, because these people are going to have to provide their qualifications to us.
If we do this every time we want to do get some manager or some official to be involved with this construction, we're going to spend a lot of times, a lot of months, in getting all the team together.
This is the first one, and this one, and that's when we talked about the methodology of it. Once they come on board, the architects and the construction manager at risk could be all done at the same time. It would not be linear. It would not have to be linear. It's getting it started at first. I just would hate to shorten that timeline because I would want really good responses.
Yes.
What we don't want to do is be in such a hurry that we make mistakes and costly mistakes on top of that. To go backwards and make corrections.
Not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about if we have a series of construction managers over this project, and you're talking about one of the biggest projects this county's ever built with the jail and the courthouse, and you got these series of top people that you're going to advertise for, and every time you advertise, you take additional, as Donna says, additional 4 to 6 weeks. That's going to take up a lot of time. If all this is up front and mm-hmm. get it done in 6 weeks, I think it's great. That's fine.
And I'm hoping, really and truly, this is the slowest part in a way. I know everyone wants to get up and move. Once we hire the program manager, you know, hopefully that won't have to be done again. That program manager, that's one of the things we're going to be looking at, someone who can stay with the duration of the project for us. And once we get the other folks on staff, we won't have to be doing this again. So I don't see that slowing it down now.
There's a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Vote on the motion.
Aye.
Those opposed? On to the next item. The next is in your binder, there is behind the program study, and this is just for your reference and information. This planning and programming study is preliminary study and work that was done to get us to where we are today, to get the cost estimates on the table, to get this in this to the voters in the SPLOST VII and as a project in SPLOST VII referendum. If you will go, I just want to point out a couple things in this. You're certainly welcome to study this later. If you'll look at the jail program is on pages 4 through 27. Again, preliminary work done with the sheriff's office and others in his department to get to this point. And this lays out of the preliminary program for the jail expansion, and then moving back to the courthouse program, which is pages 28 through 41. Again, that's something I think you've seen before. The courts worked with the consultants on this program as well, so I'm sure you're familiar with the program. And then if you go to the final page, the back page, page 55, you will see the project budget and cost estimates. Again, these are estimates based on the program planning and study that was done. And that's the number you'll see that we talked about earlier, the $100 million for the project. Most everything is built into that number. The purchase, the land acquisition, purchase of the parcels that we talked about earlier was built into this. I don't believe in this particular cost estimate the cost of borrowing funds to move forward was part of this, but I think we all understand that that would come off of the $100 million, the cost of borrowing the funds if in fact we go in that direction. So that's, again, just the summary of what the consultants have provided us up to this point to get us to this point.
If I may, this is not to say one way, though, just to share something with you. The more we borrow, if we choose to do that, the closer we get to the total amount used, or possibly going over or not. And I also may get into some of the finishes somebody may be looking for if it gets us too close to our total number. So as we may be in a hurry to get this done, you also have to take into consideration what that debt's going to cost us and if it's going to interfere in anything else we're looking to accomplish. Like maybe coming down the budget a little bit or getting a little bit different finish on the products, a little bit different quality done. As you do these, hopefully our program manager is assessing wear and tear and choosing items that may be a tad bit more expensive, but in the long run, will save us money on wear and tear items and upkeep. So all that has to come into play somewhere, somehow. So I still think that we get into our program manager and get a little bit deeper into this to find out exactly what these numbers are going to be and see if there's even money available to finance the job or if we're going to need it all for the project itself. So I don't think you've learned on that part yet to see where we really are going to be.
I don't think you want to put the cart before the horse. I think you got to get a lot further along before you can get the actual cost, because when you start talking about the actual interior of the building and all these kind of things, you're going to have projected cost. You're not going to know the real dollars.
That's correct. And I hope our program manager done enough of these that they can get some closer to dollars. And Mr. Amos and I, probably, if we go over budget, we're going to catch most heat on this. Just commissioners just did. It was the county project. So a little consideration for us, if y'all don't mind, we actually get deep into this. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Okay. The next item on the agenda is for Mr. Dave Gruen to go over some of the funding items.
Thank you, Dave. Right off, let me assure the committee and the public too that when we get a closer handle on how much we're going to need when, and this one is examples where time and money are very much closely related in timing, when we get a handle on what we're going to need when, we will recommend the best funding borrowing, if you will, with the best interest rate and terms. So when that happens, I'll give a couple of scenarios and options to see where that option may change depending when we actually have to go out for funding. I'll give you a little bit of a summary just today to explain what I mean by that. And then in future meetings, I'll update a summary page continually as we go along. Let me give you an example of where it looks like we could be right now, and one recommendation and why, and then I'll show you a little bit more of a broader scenario and how timing affects this. Cash flow is going to be the most important thing. We're going to have a cash in hand to pay the bills according to the construction schedule. And using the construction schedule that is included in the back of the book, adjusting that a little bit from the original dates, because we're a little bit later on, here's what I put together. Here's what I mentioned as a recommendation to the board commissioners not too long ago, and I'll modify this from that point. At this point, if we're able to get an architect on board to start work, and we recognize it's going to take some time to do that, not when they would start the work, but by the time we receive the first billings, if we had to pay their paying cash out as of this July, which would be pretty quick, that's probably their earliest scenario, then taking this construction schedule with the dollars placed with it and rolling out from July off for the 3.25 years that it goes through, to continue a positive cash flow through the entire project. And that means we start getting our tax proceeds in August of 2013. They start collecting in July, we get them by August. And we know a good estimate of what that cash flow would be. What it looks like at this distance is what we would need to borrow, and I'll just tell you why we recommend this particular type, would be to bond about $50 million to close on this July. Here's what the terms would look like at this point, and a lot lower cost than what we've seen in the past. And the reason why we'd recommend that as compared to the other option we would have is could we go to a bank and borrow from a bank. Municipal bond rates in particular, which you remember are tax exempt rates, so a bank cannot give us that rate, it's just they cannot go that low. Right now the market is scraping the bottom, it's extremely low, to the extent where what we were told just a couple weeks ago from underwriters, that they issued a large amount, I think it was over $200 million in Gwinnett County recently, and for a similar term, about 6 or 7 years, and they were very close to right around 1% to the cost of borrowing, which was, I don't think I've ever seen rates like that before. Using a scenario, just assuming for the cost of borrowing, I assumed at the time I put these numbers together, 2% cost, borrow $50 million through a bond with a related cost in July, that would give us sufficient cash flow following this construction schedule. The total cost would be right around, with interest and some bond costs, would be right around $5 million. Or put another way, it would leave $95 million for actual all the construction and other related costs for the project. The reason why, at this point, I recommend that compared to a bank loan, if we had a bank that would loan us $50 million online, a bank loan you probably would take draws if you need them, but it would also be a variable interest rate. A bank right now will not loan you $50 million for up to 7 years at a fixed rate. They will not do that, especially not the rates that we can get from bonds. Since rates are so low, it looks advantageous at this point, if we need the funding starting July, to lock in that low of a rate, which is around 1-2%. There's a high upside potential in interest rates that cannot go very much lower than where they are now. So that would be the one setting at that point, and why we would recommend bonds. Now, you'll see the option could change as we go along. Roughly, as each month passes, if we don't start to need cash until August or September and so on, each month that passes, because of when our cash flow starts the following year, we probably would need to borrow about $4 million less per month. And this would probably accelerate a little bit. If we were 6 months further out, and I'm not saying we hope to get to that point, because there's also construction costs to be concerned about with materials and potential labor going up, but 6 months out, or having our first payments due by the first of this next year, we would probably only need to have sufficient cash flow for the project about $25 million, actually probably closer to 20 if we only borrowed it as we needed it. At that point, if we were that far along, I would probably recommend, I mean, and all along the way, we'll probably be having discussions with the banks and seeing where they're at and what they can offer. But probably we would lean more toward negotiating a bank loan, and the type where we could borrow what we need as we went along, so like a construction loan. Because I think if we started that late, we'd probably only need that $8-10 million to get us up to the point where the sales tax collections start coming in. And at that point, a variable rate and perhaps shorter terms, trying to pay it all back a little over three and a half years into the sales tax, that would have a lower risk as far as interest rates are concerned. We wouldn't have to borrow as much, so the cost would not be as great. I don't think it would exceed, definitely be less than the $5 million, having to borrow $50 million through a bond in July. So that's sort of just little parameters to put around it. I mean, for sure, if we had a bank step up and say, we'll loan you $50 million in July and we'll give you favorable terms, depending how far we want to go back out and pay, we'll certainly entertain that. So I'm not saying we're just definitely going to do one funding method. It's going to depend when we're ready to go, what kind of costs we start to see. We've just been working off of one construction schedule and one cost estimate. One other thing on the bonds, too, it depends how you schedule them and the cost. We initially said we'd be paid with principal payments for the 6 years until the end of sales tax, the end of 2019. However, I think at one meeting, I think Commissioner Levent said, well, what if we committed all dollars from the sales tax to paying it back as soon as we could up front, which we could do on this schedule about 3.5 years into the sales tax. That would save about another $1 million off that $5 million in interest. And that just means that other projects would have to wait beyond that point. So those are the basic options, I think, what we're looking at right now. And I'll take any questions on top of that. I missed something within there. I was just trying
question.
To lay it at the table.
I don't think it was the intentions to go to one bank and say we need to borrow $50 million whenever we was discussing these projects and doing local. I think the discussion came about at some of the public meetings that we'd talk to four or five banks and we'd have one lead bank out of those banks to they'd pool their money and we'd give all the interest back locally to the banks here, which we think would be a lot cheaper than going with bonds. So as a recommending body, I'd be opposed to going with bonds because I think you'd spend a lot more money, plus it'd take a lot longer. And let's keep the money local with the local banks. I didn't have any authority, but over the period of the last 12 months, I've talked with several different banks, and that's what they would like to do. The investors would like to pool the bank's money and loan the county whatever money they need toward this. That was discussion that I had with some of them, and I think some of the board might be privy to that. But that was discussion that went on during the SPLOST referendum.
And would you have to talk with any of those bank things you can give them? Well, we're in discussions with them now. It's much easier to talk to them now when we have something a little more specific to tell them. At this point, the banks we have talked to have said, well, if it's this, it'll be that. And it's, as we get closer, it'll be easier to do, but it's definitely a good option.
Dave, if we were to bond, correct me if I understood it correctly, if we bonded, say, $50 million, that's what we have to bond.
That's
$50 million.
That's once we get a market.
But if it turns out we didn't need the whole 50, mm-hmm. we've still bonded that amount of money and got that much.
Right. Right. I mean, we still invest.
Whereas, depending upon our schedule with banks or a local right. bank consortium, whatever, that we could draw against it as we need it,
right.
therefore not creating an entire debt of $50 million.
Right. That's two things you weigh against. How much you need to buy, borrow compared to committing it all in a bond at a lower rate. And we'll pay a higher interest rate to banks, so we have to look carefully at our interest.
Understood. Yeah, there'd have to be a balance to
see
where you're.
Constantly run the numbers to see which way we think we come out better.
Right. But the point being is, if it was with banks,
you have that flexibility.
The flexibility is we only draw against what we need rather than having an entire bond of $50 million that we did not need that much cash flow, but yet we have still locked into that.
That's one of the advantages of the
terms.
My comment to Mr. Gruen back when was, what if we just pay this thing off in 3 or 4 years? The reason is because sometimes these 1 cent sales tax doesn't bring as much as you hope to bring. And I don't want to plan it out for 6 years and then find out didn't bring enough in. We're stuck with a bond that we never paid off, and that SPLOST is open. So somehow we have to keep that in mind. It happened to the school board a couple of times as well as to hold the debt from the 90s. The last thing I want to do is have that on my shoulders.
Well, I thought actually we voted on the first $100 million came in, went strictly to this project. So
that would be nice if that would go that way.
I thought that's what the project was voted on for.
Well, no, they can use some of it differently.
I think probably the board had discussion to that effect, but when it was put to the voter, that's not the way the voters voted.
No, that's right. That's what my concern was, that we at least have some kind of a safety net in there. Whether it's 4 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, but don't wait till the sixth year, because we could get stuck with owing money on the bond and there's no more money coming in on SPLOST 7. That would just work terribly. So we just got to play with that somehow.
This prison's got to stay within the parameters and the $100 million of the project. We don't over.
That's correct. I just don't want to wait to pay it off because. Then we'll start doing the other projects that are on the list for SPLOST 7, because it goes up to 189 or 180, whatever it was. But I don't want to get caught up in those doing them without paying back the jail bond. And then we get toward the end of the SPLOST and we didn't bring in as much money. And then we don't have enough to pay the bond back because we drew up to the very end.
I'd hate to be getting my tax notice and see another item on my tax notice where it's paying off paying off the jail and the courthouse with property tax.
That's right.
Like we're having to pay off green space and parks and all these things with property tax for the next 30 years.
That's,
so I don't want to have to do it. Yes.
That's why I asked Mr. Gruen if he could run the numbers where we paid back in 4 years and not wait till the end.
Yeah, this will be short term. It can be anywhere between 4.5 to 7. Why we see 7 is we go on to pay off with the sales tax collections.
And if you don't bring it up, I'm scared to get caught at the last part of it at 7.
So what do we need to decide today? Whether to borrow or whether to borrow as of July? Is that what we're talking about? Or
I think we can wait till you see how close you get to actually meeting it first. We've got two more meetings coming up between now and then, don't we?
I think without exception, if this committee so pleases, perhaps get Dave Gruen to, since we're closer now, to go ahead and run the numbers. Talk to some local banks. Perhaps those that have been in those discussions can provide Dave some names. Talk to those banks, run the numbers, and bring that information back to this committee at the next meeting. The second part of that, or actually the first part of that, or maybe in tandem, is for this committee to talk a little bit about, and I know I have two commissioners here, to talk about how do we want to fund the hiring of and the cost of the project manager, since that's going to happen pretty quickly. And so that might be something that, I don't know if Dave's thought about that, but we certainly need to talk about that, and then I would make the proposal to the board as well when we come back with the proposal to the board to hire a project manager and get an RFP out there. I will need to talk to them about how we're going to fund that.
One last thing about timing for bond issues. As far as when do we need to know as far as which way the path goes? Probably need about 2 to 3 months to get go to market with a bond issue. That's how much time we need as far as working with the underwriting. Now, we're going through a refunding issue right now, so I don't know what's involved in doing that. So 2 to 3 months, we can probably do it in 2 months, but that just means if we think those interest rates, municipal bonds are going to be more favorable than if the primary groups or banks are not just offering us a low enough rate, if we think bonds are a better option. We need to make the decision when we're within about 2 to 3 months of needing some cash flow surplus. So that's our, and we're not there yet, so I think that we're sensitive that okay. Fork in the path, if you will.
There have been some discussion about banks, and I need to make a disclosure that I'm the vice chairman of the board of the Citizens Bank of Forsyth County. And if that bank is included in any of these discussions, I would have to disqualify myself from any voting or consideration, because that would be a conflict of interest.
Mm-hmm. Thank
so
you, sir.
I want to make that formal disclosure.
I'd like to make a disclosure too that my wife serves on the board with Jeff, Captain Amos. So I would also too, if their name came up, I would have to recuse myself from any discussion with that bank or vote.
Okay. So noted. So without exception, is that the direction the committee wants to go, is to have today run some numbers and bring it back to the next meeting?
Yeah, and have some discussion with some banks.
Yeah, and if anyone's familiar with any local banks you think are interested, please let me know. We'll talk to all of them. And I think that there's been interest from the board, let me say, about working with local financing. We've never really defined that. At this point, I think I recommend those that have a presence in the county one way or another, and some are larger institutions, some are they need to be large enough to handle this kind of transaction as well. Sometimes there's a consortium of banks that work together. So have some kind of presence in the county, or if it's been a bond underwriter we've worked with before, that would at least narrow who we work with down to those. But otherwise, we're already getting people from outside the area contacting us about they want to do bond issues and other things. So.
Would it be then the desire of this committee to identify what this committee believes and then make that recommendation to the board what a local bank is, or leave that to the board of commissioners once we get to that point?
Certainly if their headquarters here in their base, or maybe more groups being local,
that one's
they've been just having a branch or two here.
Well, we don't have a lot of this headquarters here. We have the smaller banks as headquarters here in the Cumming. We don't have a lot of them that is the big banks, but the four or five that I've talked to are the smaller banks who wanted to come together as a group and have one lead bank and all of them pool for money, and that one lead bank to be the one that would deal with you on your draw. So if you wanted 50 million, 25 million, or whatever, they could come up with that as a pool.
Yeah, as long as the numbers work, I agree with that. You want to keep your money local whenever you can.
So. We can furnish some names to you, Dave.
So no action from this committee with respect to what a local bank is?
I don't think we need to go there.
Okay.
I, fact of the matter is we don't have but two or three little small local banks. I think we just need to give some names. You know, we know the banks here in the area, and we want to be sure the banks are coming for South County Bank that they operate here.
For clarification, not just a branch, but the,
the
main offices here.
The main offices here?
Yeah.
Okay.
I agree with that.
It has been this committee's desire to just have Mr. Gruen talk to those banks?
I couldn't give you the name of all the banks that would be there, so I don't know which banks they are.
Okay.
Why don't we consider this? Mr. Gruen will get with all the banks that are local, have their main headquarters here, and see if they can pull it together. If they can't, then he'll secondly have to go look at the next level of tier out, when they have a lot of branches here, employees here,
they have presence here,
and also look into your bonding sources that we've used in the past.
Gotcha.
I guess that accepts the question, though, what happened. Once again, I agree with concept. How do we define a local bank?
I think because we're the branch that have headquarters that can be here.
We got some that, not that I know, I would presume that maybe we have some that have quite a lot of branches here, do business here, but their main office might be in the just across the county line in another county. But yet they are not one of the big, you know, national banks that just have branches here. So we're back to trying to establish what's the criteria to define.
I guess we're talking about local banks. We're talking about banks that are located here in the area where they, where the headquarters out of Charlotte, where they say headquarters out of Florida.
Would you prefer the headquarters are in Georgia first, if that's at all possible, to keep some of the main funds local?
That might be that may be one way to start drawing it down. They're headquartered in Georgia. Yeah. They're chartered in Georgia, I guess.
That would help a lot, probably.
With branches here.
With branches here. With branches.
Yeah. Without exception?
Abstain. And by the way, Mr. Chairman, I've got a jury waiting on me.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Judge.
Appreciate it.
Sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Betty, thank you. The next item is to talk about the schedule. You've got that in your binder. That is certainly aspirational some time ago. And like Dave said earlier, that will just have to be shifted. And unless you want to talk about this more, I think the scheduling of this would certainly come back to this committee once a project program manager is hired and they develop a schedule for us. Donna, does that make sense?
Right. Yes,
sir. Any discussion about the schedule?
And from understanding, we've made the recommendation on a program manager. That recommendation is now going to go to the full board.
Yes.
Correct.
Yes.
And when is the earliest that the board will be able to act on that recommendation?
We can go to the next
work session.
Next work session.
March 27th.
With that request.
That'd be March 27th is the next work session.
No, you said back to the program manager. You would narrow this down to three or four. Didn't have interviews with you. You talking about interviews with this committee or interviews with the board of commissioners?
It's not usually with the board. It's usually with the selection committee.
Okay.
And then they take the recommendation to the full board for the hiring.
You said board. I want to make sure you're talking.
No, selection committee.
Selection committee.
And the selection committee would be comprised, hopefully, of a smaller number of this whole committee.
Okay, so the selection committee would be made up of members of this.
Could be, or other people.
Or perhaps several members from this committee and then some others?
It could very well be. That would be my next block for clarification. We definitely, you want someone that has some expertise. You want some of the people that are going to be dealing with it, someone with the sheriff's office, of course, someone with the court's side, someone from public facilities. Is a good mix, and then sometimes we also include, even though this is in the city of Cumming, we'd include someone from planning, or planning and development, just to ensure everyone's on board.
Is it premature to identify that evaluation committee now?
It's not premature at all.
The fact that this program manager is going to look out for the best interest of the county, their assets, and the quality of the job, that should have some consideration, I think, of who gets on the selection committee.
Does this committee, they want to move forward with Donna's direction and assign or appoint at least
selection committee.
A selection committee from this group? And then do you have suggestions today that who that who
I
might
really,
be beyond
I really
this?
Had, I really had thought the selection committee, you, on this size, you can have up to 5 people. You don't really want many more than that, just to schedule people, for one thing.
Sure.
And two, you want someone who's going to understand that they're going to be doing a lot of reading. It's a lot of reading and what they've brought forth, and be able to read that and score it. There'll be a scoring matrix in there. We're very upfront. The people that are supplying their qualifications know what we're looking at. They know what we're wanting. I would, like I said, I would say definitely someone representative of the sheriff's office, someone representative of the court systems, because they have both vested interests. Public facilities, because usually they have construction background. So they have that expertise as well, to make sure they ask the right questions. And then, again, I would go somewhere, maybe that's not on this committee, but from the planning and development for...
City of Cumming?
It says in the City of Cumming, so the definitely.
Somebody from the city planning?
I would say planning. What? That would be up to the city's direction, who they wanted to put on the committee. They know their staff better than I do.
Are you ready for recommendations today?
Sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thornton,
mm-hmm.
Would you mind doing that?
I'd be glad to, but I'd like to nominate Steve Rhodes on that part of the committee.
So you have nominated Steve?
Correct.
How about both of y'all?
But she said only 5.
Yeah.
Would that be too many?
I think
so.
Yes.
Would
you want to serve on
them? No. Captain Smith on that.
Captain
Smith. Yes, Captain Smith.
Don, I know that.
Do that.
Courts will advise us at a later date.
Do you need to be on? You want to be on, Don?
I am on it, but I do not vote.
Okay.
I am the person that reads them and make sure everyone sees all the information and make
and
sure
it's they're understanding how to score it correctly.
Exactly.
Very good.
So
I'm definitely on there.
Mr. Chairman, I would nominate Scott Morgan, Director of Planning and Zoning, and his department would be the one that would be permitting all of the permits that goes on and inspections and so forth. So he would be the one I would nominate to work on.
Thank you. You think Tim would mind serving on this thing, Tim Merritt?
That would be a great idea.
Somebody from besides?
Sure.
Tim. That'd be 5. I was 5 of them.
Yep. It's a nice mix. And I will say, since we've, you know, pretty much determined who will be on the selection committee, once the solicitation goes out, the selection committee really is almost sequestered. They are not going to be discussing it with anyone else. They'll be talking it amongst ourselves. They definitely cannot talk to any of the people that have supplied information to us. Any questions during that period do need to come through my department only, just to make sure it's a fair and even playing field. So I'm going to just saying that because we have a lot of folks here. I just want to be very clear that that's not acceptable. Thank you.
Okay. It sounds to me like we've got the 5, but
you're not included in the 5.
No, okay. I'm, yeah.
Then the motion might be to select Chuck Smith from the Sheriff's Office, Steve Rhodes from Public Facilities, Forsyth County Public Facilities, Tim Merritt, Deputy County Manager, Forsyth County, and Scott Morgan with City Planning Department, Mayor?
Yes.
Planning Department. And then if that's acceptable to the board, this committee, and in addition, it's acceptable to this committee to allow Don to talk to the member being Judge Bagley to make their assignment. Perhaps then we wouldn't need to come back to this committee for that. Do we just trust that they would make an assignment?
So moved.
Yes, second.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Hearing none, that passes. So you've got your selection.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. With the exception of maybe discussing when you'd like to schedule the next meeting, is there anything else you'd like to bring to the committee at this time?
I think we have a strong committee here, and I'm looking forward to getting this project started as soon as possible.
That's good.
Make tremendous value to our county and the city.
Okay. I do have one other item I thought about during the agenda. I realize you nominated and voted for me as chairperson. Is there any thought given to potentially having a vice chair in to serve in my absence, if in fact I were to not be able to make one of the meetings, or just want to handle it if I'm not able to make a meeting for some reason? So it's up to y'all.
We'd like to be able to blame you.
Absolutely, not sure.
Not allowed to make all
here.
Be sick.
That's correct. Keep eating healthy, keep riding your bicycle, you'll be good.
Dies for lack of emotion. Thank you. Anything else to come before the committee? You want to talk about a meeting, or would you like us to work on what you've given us and then schedule something at a later date?
Basically, program manager should be our next meeting.
Is there any business of importance we need to discuss prior to coming back for a recommendation on the program manager?
The RFP that I'll submit is pretty standard. I mean, I'll ask for lots of qualifications. I don't know if you'd like to see it before it goes out, or if anyone else would like to see the qualification part. That's up to you if you want to see that or not. Sometimes people do, some people don't. I don't mind sending that out. As soon as I can get that done, I'll get the board's approval, hopefully on the 27th, to move forward, and I can start working on those requirements now. And like I said, that will be out on the street. And once we get them back, I don't know if you'd like to meet then, just to know, so you would know, or I can communicate to you how many responses we've had and the initial selection committee's review. I mean, that will be quite some time, a number of weeks.
My suggestion would be maybe if we meet after the closed day.
Okay.
That between then time. And those proposals being then presented to the evaluation committee.
That sounds good.
As a entire board, we met at that time.
Okay.
That's fine.
That's fine. And that will, once the board approves it, the full board approves it, then I can give you a closing date.
Okay.
I can't give that to you until that happens.
Anything else come before this committee? If not, motion adjourned.
I'll move.
Okay.
Right.
In the favor?
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to go to the next one.
Let's take care of the project and even.
That's a good point.
Even money quality. That building for usable space inside. I mean, if you and leftover stuff or whatever, you know, just kind of make it match the flow. In the whole project, you just hate to see a black eye sitting next to something new, maybe on the downtown, just that works in. Starbucks? No, yeah, great. Thanks
for bringing that.
How are you?